So that's just a little bit about myself. So let's get right into it. What we're going to be talking about today is mass casualty incidents with a little bit of focus on the active shooter, because I think sometimes we get a little preoccupied with just one focus. And really, our MCI procedure and our MCI plan should be all-encompassing. It should be the all-risk type of procedure. So it doesn't matter if it's a natural disaster, a man-made disaster, an active shooter, a bombing, a machete, doesn't matter what it is, it should be the exact same procedure. So what is an MCI? We have a lot of different definitions throughout the country, but I think overwhelmingly the one that we have now come to agree upon is anything overwhelming to the first arriving units. And that's kind of gotten to be inadequate resources to meet the immediate needs. And we know that the MCIs are occurring every day. Just this morning, unfortunately, there was a school bus collision in Tennessee with two school buses collided with two children dead, one adult killed, and 23 injured. So we must have a method of triaging, treating, and transporting the injured, no matter what type of MCI is. And a lot of people have gotten focused on the name. This is my active shooter plan. No, it's the active killer plan, the hostile situation. I think that we should all come to agreement that they're all MCIs, and some of them do have law enforcement involvement. So instead of having just a plan for active shooters, just a plan for a bombing or a kit for an active shooter or active killer, that it should be all-encompassing in our MCI plan. So let's just talk a little bit, though, about active shooter, because that's some of the new things that are coming out in the last couple years. Probably a lot of you are aware of the active shooter statistics that have been published in many, many journals. Primarily the male shooter, primarily in the daytime. A lot of them are occurring at the workplace there, 51%. What I like is the bottom one there that I have bolded, that the average lasts about 12 minutes and 37% lasts less than 5 minutes. So 93% of them are over before we are arriving on scene. So that just says to me that we can do a lot better than what we're doing right now with getting in and getting some medical care for some patients. So what happened after the 1999, the Columbine shooting? The whole law enforcement had a paradigm shift of how they respond to an active shooter situation. Prior to the Columbine situation, their procedure was primarily to get on scene, wait until the SWAT team came, and then try to negotiate hostage negotiations and try and just negotiate with the person. Well, we know when this incident occurred, the active shooter, that these people had did not want to get involved in any type of negotiations. They just wanted to kill as many people as they could. And after Columbine is when the law enforcement paradigm shifted, that now the first arriving police officer, maybe one or two, three, four, whatever the tactics specifically are for that department, they go in. They don't wait for any type of specialized team to get there. It's the first arriving units. And you can see some of the statistics there from Columbine. Coach Sanders bled for over 2 hours inside the classroom before he died. So in 2012, unfortunately, we had 9 active shooter incidents. The one that we all know of, the Sandy Hook incident that occurred. In 2013, a large group of national recognized organizations got together. The International Association of Fire Chiefs, the Police Chiefs, the FBI, Homeland Security, the International Association of Firefighters, the Metro Chiefs, you can see them all there, the United States Fire Administration. They all held a meeting in Hartford, Connecticut, and they developed a document that's called the Hartford Consensus. And really what they wanted to do with this document is to develop the stated purpose of the document is to increase survivability to mass casualty shootings, describe methods to minimize the loss in these type of incidents. And it's really the initial actions that they put into this document, and they have now since met since this, and just really, I think this is a great document. If you haven't read it, you really should. And what it encompasses is recommending integration of law enforcement and fire rescue agencies, EMS agencies, with the critical actions, the mnemonic they came up with is threat. So threat suppression, that's going to be your law enforcement getting in and neutralizing the suspect. Hemorrhage control, rapidly getting on the tourniquets, getting rapid extrication to safety, removing the victims, assessment by the medical providers, and transport to definitive care. And since the Hartford consensus has come out, you can see there on the slide, a lot of other great documents have come out. The FEMA one, Operational Considerations for Guide for Active Shooter and MCIs, is an excellent resource as well. So since the Hartford consensus came out and all of those other documents, we looked at all of those documents together and really came up with a consensus of what is in those documents and what can we do. Well, I think really we need, on the EMS fire rescue side, we need a paradigm shift just like what happened with the law enforcement previously. We need to work with our law enforcement agencies and rapidly get into what we call the warm zone and get the care for the victims. Now, we would still want to have the contact team, the police officers, the contact teams, go in and neutralize the suspect. So they're going to go in and search. And then we're going to have our personnel form a rescue task force, the RTF team. And our rescue task force depends on the agency, whether it's two paramedics and five police officers or three paramedics and four police officers, the numbers are not consistent. It's just a team of firefighters, paramedics, and a team of law enforcement officers. So they work together going in. They're going to go in the same place that the contact team has gone in, where the contact team has gone in and searched the area. And then they're continuing to move on and searching for the suspect. So we call that the warm zone. So our personnel would be moving in with law enforcement, with that rescue task force, and getting in to the warm zone. To do this, to get our personnel in, we have to have a strong command. We have to have the police agencies and the fire agencies or EMS agencies form a unified command, working together, command officers deciding what areas have been searched, what areas are we going to send our rescue task force in. So that would be definitely a consideration that we want to get our personnel in safely with the unified command. The law enforcement officers, when they're part of a rescue task force, they're to provide security for those EMS personnel that are going in. So they're not to do anything else except stay exactly with our rescue task force. That's what forms the rescue task force and go into that warm area. So there's a couple things that rescue task force is going to be doing. The primary objective is going to be getting medical care to the victims within hopefully minutes. And the primary thing they're going to be doing is getting tourniquets on to the people that are hemorrhaging. There are a lot of classes that you can take that review this rescue task force concepts and some different things of what the rescue task force can do, how to rapidly get in and provide treatment. A couple of them are the classes offered by the NAEMT, which is the LEFR course, the Law Enforcement First Responder course, 8-hour course. I recommend that for all fire rescue, EMS, and law enforcement. It would be a great class for a combined group to take. There's also the Tactical Emergency Casualty Care course. That one's a little bit longer, And again, they're both offered by the NAEMT. So to do this rescue task force concept, though, you also have to keep in mind that all agency heads, so your police chief, your fire chief, EMS, they all have to come to agreement and work on this concept prior to an incident. So at our agency here, we've been working on the rescue task force concept for about 8 months, and we have been actively training. Every Tuesday, we send a group of personnel to go to the, work with the law enforcement agency and get in and work with the concept to get in and provide immediate care. I like this statement that really, overall, what we're doing, I think Mr. Mitchell from the USFA said it perfectly. The overall goal is to plan, prepare, and respond to save the maximum number of lives. So all of us working together is definitely the best way to go. How we can get in and provide immediate care safely to the victims in any type of incident. To do that, we have to have a strong ICS incident command system. All of the personnel right now should be very familiar with this. We have had these field operation guides on their screen there for, I would say, over 15 years available in the state of Florida. The only thing you'll see that these have changed recently is the color coding. They used to be color-coded pages. Feedback from the fire rescue agencies have asked that they not be each page colored, but go ahead and make the heading colored so that they're easier for photocopying. And all of these colors match the vests that your ICS vest. So if you're the treatment officer, you should be wearing a red vest. I strongly recommend having these on all units. Have an MCI bag and have the equipment right there so you don't have to wait for a specialized unit to get on scene. So talking about violent incident, active shooter, WMD, terrorist event, or just a straight MCI, there's a lot of things that we can be doing ahead of time while we're responding to a call. We definitely want our dispatchers, our communication center personnel trained and a set of questions to ask. Always consider it a secondary device. Maybe they'll have the law enforcement go in and do a sweep. Any type of incident involving law enforcement, remember, you want to make sure that scene is secure, not just law enforcement is on scene. So there is a huge difference with that. We could use, when we arrive on scene, we could use binoculars, look at the patients running out of an area, or their red skin, or watery eyes, blistering, so maybe we don't want to get in. We want to make sure we do a quick and safe windshield survey, almost like a rapid impact assessment on the area that the victims are in, and really provide a good scene size up to tell all responding agencies or personnel coming in of what they have. So when we arrive on scene, we're going to establish command, get the ICS system up and running. I like pre-assigning personnel en route. On your arrival, Rescue 1, I want you to be the triage officer. Rescue 2, you can be the treatment officer. Rescue 5, I want you to be the transport officer. So while some of these units are responding, they can start thinking about what they need to do. And then you can keep on going, with your assignments as the group functions are needed. So we always want to work with our police on any type of mass casualty. We're going to establish an incident perimeter and think about that not only on a hazmat scene, but on any type of incident. Where the victims are is your hot zone. And then you have your warm zone where we want to limit our personnel, and then the cold zone. If you have a bullhorn or PA system, we want to direct our patients using that. Make sure all personnel are wearing the proper PPE. This is the command field operation guide. You can see the highlighted yellow there. We've added some information on the rescue task force and we'll go over some of that as we go along. But we just wanted, this is a quick field operation guide, just bullet statements for personnel, to the command personnel, to think about what they need. And on the other side of the page, the back of the page, is the state of Florida's recommended predetermined response plan. So it kind of, it goes by levels. So we have level 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5. So they vary by victim count. And then we have the units responding that match with that level. So just as an example, MCI level 3 is 21 to 100 victims. We would have 8 transport units, 4 suppression units, 3 shift supervisors, battalion chiefs, EMS chiefs, and some of the supply trailers or command vehicles, and the hospitals would also be notified. And you can see how it escalates up or down from that level 3 that I have listed there. This is just a sample of the complex, your everyday, like this morning, the Tennessee bus crash, your MCI command structure. It's going to be a hectic scene. You have command, which will be above the medical branch, and they will be handling all of the other things that go along with any type of incident, if it's a hazmat, if it's a fire, and then they'll break it down to a medical branch. And you can see the triage group has the triage teams, the litter bearers, and the medical examiners. The treatment group has all the personnel doing the treatment. And then as if it's a larger incident, you have people just in charge of the red area, the yellow, and the green, and then your transport group officer definitely needs some aids, the documentation aid, and your medical communication coordinator, just talking to the hospitals. So when we're talking about utilizing the rescue task force, the rescue task force is going to go under the triage group, and we need to make sure that we have communication with them at all times. They're the ones in the hazard area. They're the ones that we want to make sure we account for. And then you're still going to have victims running outside, carried outside, so you will still need triage teams outside. Litter bearers and medical examiners will still fall under the triage group, and then the treatment and transport group stay the same. This is just to show you some of the resources that we have in the state of Florida. These are our MCI supply trailers that you can see where they're distributed throughout the state. The bottom picture here is the Broward County, is the host of the Broward County State trailer. So they have 50 backboards, a lot of different supplies. The top trailer is in Broward County. We have 4 trailers that we've gotten on grants, and they are stocked, as the picture is showing there, where the rack, the whole rack, can come right out and go to a treatment area. They have red, yellow, green, and black tents that can be set up if needed, and they have additional MCI supplies and 50 backboards as well in the top MCI trailer. The triage officer, as we just saw on the organizational chart, is in charge of the rescue task force. So we included some of the rescue task force information on the triage field operation guide. And we have the MCI bag. Those of you that are in Broward County, this is the MCI backpack that we're going to be getting. We have a couple grants. They're not large enough for all of the agencies that we have in Broward, but these are the bags that we're going to be getting. And you see it doesn't say active shooter bag or bombing bag or airplane crash bag. It's just an MCI bag. In that bag is going to be 2 fanny packs, so for 2 personnel. And what we've added the supplies to be is we will have a total of 14 tourniquets, 14 chest seals, 14 decompression, and 14 hemostatic dressings, as well as the triage ribbons and field operations guide. So why the number 14? Because you have the fanny packs that have 2 of each of the items that we said, and then so that's the 4, and then you have an additional pack on the bottom of the backpack that has additional supplies of 10. So the concept is you put on your fanny pack and you take the backpack in with you at whatever MCI you're going to. You know, if it's a shooting or whatever type of incident it is, you're going to put both of those on, the fanny pack and the backpack, and go into the area. And then on the top for the triage officer, you have the vest and you have the paperwork. Here's just a couple considerations for the rescue task force. You have to have communication with the triage officer. And we have done several drills, and the triage officer himself is just too busy to keep that constant contact with the rescue task force. So the triage officer needs an aide just to communicate with the rescue task force. In a large building as a school, you're going to need more than one rescue task force. So as you keep building the rescue task force, you're just going to keep numbering. Rescue task force one, I want you to go in and search these five buildings, five rooms. Rescue task force two, you're going to go into this area. We have found an issue with marking of which rooms have been searched. So trying a lot of different ways of doing it, the way that we have found and we're recommending is to go ahead and use the grease pencil, which is in the fanny packs, in the backpacks, multiple ones, and right on the door of a school or a building, the door of the room, how many victims are in that area. So R would be your red, yellow, green, and black. Just line them up and write how many. Now, you shouldn't have any greens left in the area, but you could have having them assist you with some treatment. And so they may stay, whether it's a parent or a teacher. So that's why we want to mark down. You don't need to mark anything else. Really quick, mark it on the door. That way we know it's been searched, and it's easy to do. You can practice this in training because it's just a grease pencil. We're not spray painting anything. It can come right off. The ballistic gear, each agency is going to have to decide that amongst themselves, whether they're going to be providing vests and helmets for the rescue task force personnel. So our initial triage, no matter what type of MCI we have, right now we're using START and JumpStart for our pediatric patients. We're using our triage ribbons tied preferably to the wrist, our upper extremity, making sure they're visible. First thing that we do for START or JumpStart is come in and evacuate the walking wounded. So as all of you know, anybody that can walk, come out and send them to a specific location. And then we're just going to start where we stand and assess all the non-moving patients. On the bottom is a couple of examples of the triage fanny packs that we have. So the one with the three-bag kind of setup is the one that was sent out by the state about 4 years ago. So every ALS agency in the state got that fanny pack with just the ribbons in it. Now, it needed equipment. It was supposed to be a bigger style, but that's what we got. We changed the top of it because the top of it had a START algorithm that hopefully all of our personnel know START. So we took that START algorithm out and we put that piece of paper that you see there to laminate it so we could keep track of how many patients we have, and we have the grease pencils. Then we added the little pouch that has some tourniquets and combine dressings and quick clot hemostatic dressing in it. So it's very easy for you to do. We had those pouches from some of our old airway bags and just thread it through. So if you have those ones with just the ribbons, I strongly encourage you to have another type of bag to have the equipment. Then the other fanny pack you can see is a larger bag. It can supply the two tourniquets, the quick clot, the hemostatic dressing, the chest decompression needles. Everything can fit right in that fanny pack. So you're going to put the fanny pack on, and then you're going to put your backpack on as well. So when we're doing START and JumpStart, or we're doing triage, whatever type of triage we're doing, you know, a lot of focus on that is just get in and put the ribbons on. Well, we need to do just a little bit of treatment when we're in doing in that triage mode. And, you know, a lot of the wars and the conflicts are awful, except they provide us great data, great information. And really, this is where this information has come, that from of the three main causes of preventable death, external hemorrhage accounts for 60% of them. So the key to preventing that is early recognition, acknowledge that they're bleeding out, aggressive treatment, ensuring the correct skills and equipment. So making sure we provide the tourniquets and the training to our personnel that we could assist and lower that rate of external hemorrhage, 60%, the preventable death. So when we are in that triage mode, we do want to quickly get on tourniquets, do chest decompressions, and open airway. Those are the three things that we want to do in the triage mode. The CAT tourniquet has been rated the best by the military. It works great. We carry it. I know there are a lot of other ones out there. It's, I guess, each agency can use whatever one that their medical director approves of. We like the CAT, and I like the orange one so that it stands out, so it's easily able to be seen that the person has a tourniquet on. Okay, so back to our ICS system. We have the treatment officer. This has not changed. You have the treatment vest, the red vest, and the paperwork for the treatment officer. You can see the tarps down on the bottom. Again, every agency in the state of Florida several years ago was given a tarp set, and in Broward County you should have three or four of these tarp sets somewhere in your system and available for you. The triage log. So this is the first step where we start trying to document our patients, who's in our treatment area, what color are they, and has the victim's condition changed. That's why we have the ribbon color and then the tag number. So initially with currently start or jump start, all patients are triaged, initially tagged with a ribbon, and then on secondary assessment, they're giving the triage tag. I think this is a great example of a treatment area. This is, you can see the LA train crash. On the bottom there, you can see they have a red area, yellow area, and a green area with a really nice loading zone set up for the units to come through. It does look chaotic, but I think any MCI is going to be chaotic. And to me, this looks like organized chaos that they do have the patients funneling in. You can see most of the responders there are in the red area, so that's perfect. And then those patients will be transported first. So our secondary triage, again, is done in the treatment phase, and we're going to be using the all-risk triage tags. Again, this was sent out to all ALS agencies in the state. We see a lot of problems with this tag that a lot of people leave the pink strip on. So remember, if the patient is not contaminated, they should not have that pink strip left on. So that pink strip would come off after they're decontaminated, if they are contaminated, and if they, it would go into a bag with their clothing if they are contaminated, and then that way that clothing can be tracked back to that patient. So you can see the gentleman down here in the red treatment area, he still has a red ribbon on, and then he has the tag on, and the pink strip is still on. So the pink strip should come off, and the ribbon should come off, because really if they have the tag on, that's the most important. That's when we spent a little more time and did a more thorough assessment, whatever we had time to do on the triage tag itself. Another thing that we see is that the tops of the tags are not taken off. So you have one top, one piece of the tag that says personal property receipt. So that could go with somebody's purse or bag, something that you want to track back to that patient. And then the next one is this destination via a patient's name. So that should help the transport officer track the patient. So if the people in the treatment area can fill out that tag as much as possible, and then in the loading zone, they can quickly document what patient went to what hospital. And here's the transport's field operation guide. Again, the green vest, and you have the transport field operation guide. Transport officer is a key officer. You have to have a strong person in this role to try and track the patients. So this person, really recommend having some training, trying to track down what patient went to what hospital. And here we have our paper transport log. So this tells us what patient, what color, went to what unit, went to what hospital by what unit. So it tracks everything. If we don't have an electronic system, this is what we have to track. I would try and use these on any type of MCI that you have from, you know, 6, 7, 8 patients, start using this log. Again, it really takes some practice, but it's all there for you to help you if you know how to use it. Same exact thing with the hospital capability worksheet. In Broward County, we would call our medical communication center, MedCom. MedCom will call all of the hospitals, do a roll call, and they will give you the hospitals accepting patients in this order. So Broward Health can accept 5 trauma alerts, just as an example. You would write that 5 under accepting, and then as you transported trauma alerts, you would just put some hash marks in that line, and then you got to 5, you would go to the next one. So if you're not familiar with this form, again, it really can be crazy for you to try and figure out how it works. So again, any drills that you're having, any MCI, smaller scale, I really encourage you to use this form. If you are going computer, hand-based, I know in Broward County, all of the agencies, participating agencies got this handheld scanner, and we also have tethered scanners. I do think this is in the future. That we can get there. This does make our life a lot easier instead of handwriting everything. But again, it does take a lot of practice. These are the screens for the EM track that you can just go right initially to triage. You triage the patient, and then you put what color they are, male, and then what hospital they went to. Again, it takes a lot of practice, and obviously we have to have the equipment. This is the main screen. This is the screen that I would like to have on all of the tough books so that any command officer on a scene of an MCI would be able, if the patient got scanned in with, I think the easiest thing would be to have a tethered scanner and a tough book, and then any command officer, whether it's the medical branch or command officer, can look right at this and you can see what patient has been transported. By what agency. So you can see Davy Fire Rescue is transported 1 red, 2 yellows, so a total of 5 patients. And then you can click on those numbers and see exactly what the patient's information is. We've added this active shooter incident field operation guide. And it just kind of has everything that we just talked about with our threat acronym, the threat suppression, hemorrhage control, rapid extrication assessment, and transport treatment to definitive care, talking about the warm zone, the rescue task force. So again, just some bullet statements, trying to use them in training and definitely use them on calls. All right, that is the overview of the MCI procedure. And now I'm going to talk just a little bit about SALT. So SORT, assess, life-saving intervention, treatment, and transport. So we're just going to call it SALT triage method. So really, this is not new. It came out in 2011. The CDC put together a large group of people, and they wanted to develop a a national standard for mass casualty triage. They looked at research evidence, practical evidence, compared features of all the systems available, and what they determined was no one system was supported by the evidence. So they came up with SALT. So they said, simple, it's easy to remember, you can group large numbers of patients quickly together, and it does have the concept of delivering the rapid life-saving interventions very quickly, put right into the SALT method. So here you have the document that it's all out of. You guys should look at this and be familiar with this document. So the National Implementation of Model Uniform Core Critical Criteria for Mass Casualty Incident Triage. So they just call it the MUCC document. And this is what the CDC's recommendations came out, and this is where the SALT method is. So it recommends that the state and local EMS systems improve their MCI triage capabilities through adoption of triage protocols and systems that are based on the MUCC. Federal resources may be used to support development of capabilities which improve EMS system preparedness for mass casualty triage. And they have some strategies that are put into this document. So one is through education, so getting everybody on board and, you know, throughout your area, throughout the state, providing the education, providing assistance. You see that in strategy 2 and 3, enhance federal preparedness and grants. So I see both of these strategy 2 and 3 telling me that if we're looking for MCI grants, we have got to move towards MUCC compliant triage system, which is SALT. And then incorporate that obviously into our training and to our implementation. So talking about SALT, it uses the same colors as START as we've been using, so the international color coding, red, yellow, green, and black, with the addition of gray. And here is the overall schematic of the full triage process, and then we're going to go through and break down each step. The key to remember in the SALT is the step one is the SORT that we're going to be talking about. And then we go through and provide individual assessment as it goes through. So step one is we're going to do a global sorting. So kind of going to sound a little familiar. We're going to come into the room. Anybody that can walk, come out of the room, come out of the area, and send them to a specific location. Sound familiar, I hope. Then we're going to say, anybody that can hear me, I want you to wave your arm. So that's the wave there, step two. Now, those patients will let us know that they can comprehend what we're saying and that they can actually physically move their arm or move, you know, wave their hand. So that category then will probably tell us that the other victims are probably the red or the gray or the black patients. So we have our walking, our green patients, the wave purposeful movement, probably going to be our yellow, and then we have our still and our gray patients. So here's kind of what I just said. The still with the obvious life threats are going to be the red, gray, or black. The priority two, the waving purposeful movement, are probably going to be our yellow. The walking will be our green. And then we move to the next step, which is to assess all of our non-ambulatory victims, where they lie, and then provide the 4 life-saving interventions, obviously based on your scope of practice, training, authorization. And we want you to bring in the equipment. Again, have a bag available to you. You're not going to, you know, run back out to your unit for any type of a treatment. Primarily, we want you to have the tourniquets. So then let's move to the LSI, life-saving intervention. So they incorporated what we know as jumpstart into SALT. So you see the open the airway, if child considered too rescue breath. So that ventilatory trial that was in Jumpstart is now right included into the LSI in SALT. So SALT would be for adults and children. So once we have the walking wounded all out of the room, we want to think about the LSI, primarily that's going to be our tourniquets, and then move over to the next set of patients. So here we have, if you look at some of the list here, it says obeys command, has a peripheral pulse, not in respiratory distress, major hemorrhage is controlled, and then yes or no, and it branches out. And we'll cover each one of those. So our dead, I think everybody can figure out the patients that are deceased. We want to mark them with our black ribbon or the black and white stripe, whichever one you have. This is after we've opened the airway. And for children that have peripheral pulse, that we're going to give the two rescue breaths. If there's no breathing, then they're going to be deceased. You never move the deceased patients unless you have to move them to get to a live patient. So the driver of the bus is dead. We want to get onto the bus. We can't. We have to move the patient. And if you have an opportunity to move the patient, say it's a structure fire and the person's at the door and you have time to move the deceased victim out of the way before the body is consumed, you can do that, or if they die in our treatment area. Other than that, we want to leave the deceased where they are and let the medical examiners handle the deceased patients. Here's the new category, the gray. So we will be looking to add a gray ribbon to our fanny packs. So this will be on, remember, initial assessment. So this is the patients that are critical, that they're very unlikely to survive given the available resources. And most of them are unlikely to survive in the best of circumstances. So you have the 90% burns, the multi-trauma, brain matter showing, the patient that is breathing, as an example, 4 times a minute, 6 times a minute, and you just know they're not going to survive, but do you mark them dead or do you mark them red and use the resources? So this is that in-between category of gray, that as soon as you have available resources, so your reds have been transported, or your reds have been moved to the treatment area, and you get more resources, you can see if that gray is probably deceased by that time, but that's the time to do it. So you don't want to work a trauma code. So it doesn't mean they're dead at that time. It just means you don't have the resources to work on them, as I said, the trauma code, let's say. If you have time, maybe you want to consider some pain control for these patients, and you get to them as soon as you can get the red patients moved. So here's our red category. So remember, we're in SALT. This should be a little familiar to us. If you look at START, we looked at RPMs, respiration, perfusion, and mental status. Well, if we look at SALT, we have respiratory distress, respirations, perfusion, and mental status. So it's very similar, respiration, perfusion, and mental status. The only thing you don't see there is a number. So remember, with START, respirations over 30, they're automatically a red. So there is no numbers in SALT, just respiratory distress, no peripheral pulse, does not follow commands, uncontrolled hemorrhage. And then we look at these patients, are they likely to survive or not given the resources that we have? So these patients have immediate life-threatening conditions. Our yellow are delayed, our serious injuries, they need help. The respirations, if we look at the our RPM there, respirations, perfusion, and mental status, I call are stable. So our RPMs are stable. The bleeding is controlled. So if your RPMs are stable, they're okay. That really only leaves you yellow or green left. Our green patients require minor to no care, right? They're in it. They're RPMs, respiration, perfusion, and mental status, again, are stable. Hemorrhage is controlled. We do need somebody to stay with them. It's like, I like that picture. It's like herding cats. If somebody doesn't stay with them, that they start wandering everywhere. Now, if they have the non-injured victims that these patients, well, they're not really patients, they're not injured, but these participants, these people involved, you can use them to assist you. Hold this bleeding, holds pressure on this bleeding wound, or, you know, comfort this patient, or hold this baby for me. So you can put them to work if you need them to. But again, have someone stay with that group and have someone as soon as possible go through and evaluate this group of people. You will have people that get up and get out of the area that are critically injured. So conduct a triage on them. So why should we change the SALT? Well, it's now CDC recommended. It's in the MUCC document. The global sorting that they do with the walking wounded, moving out the area, and then the wave should identify your yellows and greens. Your LSI, life-saving interventions, are addressed very early, getting that tourniquet on, chest decompression, or hemostatic dressing as soon as you can. You have that gray category. The SALT combines adult and pediatric triage. With START, you have the potential for over-triage, just as an example, respirations over 30, that maybe they're just hyperventilating, so you calm them down, they're perfectly fine. So you can over-triage, and START does use the capillary refill, which is not recommended anymore. We've kind of taken that out of our training for the last several years, but if you do look at the START flow chart, that is still in the flow chart itself. And I'm just going to read you a little statement out of the MUCC, and it says, after comparing both triage systems, SALT and START, it appears that both have the potential for over-triage. However, the SALT triage system seems to combine a lot of other triage protocols in its development, and the application takes a more scientific and data-driven approach. The biggest attraction is the global sorting. By doing the global sorting method, triage personnel can quickly establish three zones and potentially use the walking wounded to help other individuals at the scene. SALT triage system also takes into account of the pediatric patient in its LSI protocol. It provides a more thorough evaluation before tagging the patient black or dead by performing a quick LSI interventions. Finally, it further triages the patient into the expectant, that gray category, by accounting for the amount of resources available at the scene. With all of these advantages stated, SALT is by no means the perfect triage system. It is just a better one among the current ones. However, all these protocols will continue to be refined as we gain a deeper understanding of mass casualty management and the future evidence is collected to identify an optimal disaster triage method. And here's just a little comparison of what I did with START and SALT. So they're both using the same international color coding, with SALT adding the gray. Step one, it's basically the same, clearing out the walking wounded, and SALT added the wave in between. Both systems address the RPM, but SALT doesn't have the values, so you don't have the confusion with that. SALT addresses the LSI early. And both systems, if we combine START and jump START, address the child not breathing, but SALT does have it combined into it. These are all of the organizations that have already endorsed SALT and through the MUCC. So you'll see there's a lot of them there. So to wrap up, the general principles of an MCI. Your rescue task force, I encourage you to work with your local law enforcement agencies, develop some protocols, practice that unified command. I see that as a weak point between fire and police and EMS agencies. We need to have that unified command. Make sure your agencies have the right equipment. Get them the extra supplies that they can carry in very quickly. For triage, move as quickly as you can. Use the ribbons first with salt or start, whatever you're currently using. So we're going to use our triage ribbons first, and then the tags with a more thorough assessment in the triage area or the triage phase. Get a transport officer as soon as you can. I like doing it en route. Get that person on the radio, getting them to talk to the hospitals very quickly to let them know that they need to start calling the hospitals to get them to activate their MCI plans. We want it, our goal is to get the red patients off to the hospital as soon as possible. And we really need to practice. It doesn't have to be 300 patients. Start with 10 patients and just use the procedure, triage, treatment, transport, with the paperwork, with the ribbons and the tags, and that will be just as effective as your 300 patients. Because if you have the procedure down, it doesn't really matter how many patients you have. There are a lot of training that is available. The National Disaster Life Support Foundation has an online SALT triage program. They also do the basic and advanced disaster life support course, which is a great course. I took that several years ago, and that's when I was first introduced to SALT. They went through the whole system, and afterwards I said, is this a brand new system? I had never heard of this SALT triage. And they told me, no, it's since 2011 that it's been recommended. It's great, that course, if you take that, the National Basic or Advanced Disaster Life Support course. The Tactical Emergency Casualty Care, they have great courses, the TECC and the Law Enforcement First Responder course we talked about. A lot of other resources there. Here's a lot of the references that I used to put this together. Any questions?
All right. Actually, Chief Downey, that was awesome. Really, great overview of what we've been doing for years, but also now what we are doing moving forward. And we do have a question here from Sophia Mosier from Coral Springs. And Sophia says, "Is everyone going to SALT now?" She's curious to know, are we going to be changing the Broward County protocols? Or are you just making that as a general recommendation?
Okay. We are not changing this minute. I have done a presentation to the last state EMS advisory meeting. I will be doing another one at the Fire Rescue East EMS advisory meeting for the disaster committee this coming January. We are going to be recommending that we move to SALT, but we do understand that it will take a long time in the state to move over to it. Right now, the main thing that we would have to do is add a gray ribbon. We can do that. That's not that hard to do. The new backpacks that we're getting and fanny packs that we're getting on the grant that we do have available, I am going to go ahead and put the gray ribbon in it, so that we will have it available. Some systems, Palm Beach County, I think there are some personnel from Palm Beach County, they have already changed to it. So we are going to be moving towards it. I would say in the next year that I would see us moving towards it, that we should start training our personnel on it. I don't see it being a huge change. And I really made it summarize that I hope that you see that there's a lot of similarities between SALT and START.
Right, and I would agree with you. I think that we should probably look at 2015 to ultimately get SALT in to our protocols and to start to train. You don't see it as much of a big cost here, right? You're saying a gray ribbon and training essentially is where the
right, because and a lot of people will say, oh, what about the tags? Because the tags say START on them. But we are not using START. I when we developed the tags, I wanted to start right off those tags to begin with, but some people wanted it as a refresher. So we shouldn't be using start when we're using those tags. So start and salt is only used when we're using the ribbons. When we use the tags, we should be doing a better assessment, our normal assessment, and not salt or start when we're using the tags. So I'm going to request that the state purchases new tags for us, and hopefully through some grants they'll be able to do that, but I don't see that being a hang-up for us to not move to salt.
Right, so let me just clarify. The actual tags are only to be used in the cold zone. The ribbons, the gray ribbon, if you're a gray expectant patient and you're sitting inside in the warm zone and you're gray, you're never going to make it outside. No one's ever going to use the tag on you anyway. So if you're inside and you're expectant and not going to be brought out, then there's no gray needed on that patient except for the ribbon. And the ribbon will be upgraded to red if you decide to treat that patient. If you have more resources and you change that patient to a red, they become red anyway. So those tags, just remove the word start from it, and they're still useful. So that's not really an item that needs to be paid for.
Correct. So our gray patients, we're and I wouldn't say in a building or out of a building, wherever the MCI is, the middle of the highway, and you have a guy that's breathing four times a minute and he's got some brain matter showing, you know, we could mark him gray, but we're not going to work a trauma code. And then when we get back to him, he's either going to still be breathing and we can bump him up to a red, or he's deceased. So then we would go with our tags and he would be a red or a black, and we would, you know, transport or not. So gray is just that initial triage to decide if we're going to work them or not, and then you can move them, upgrade them, if that's what you had enough resources, to a red for the transport criteria.
Right. So you know what? I don't see any reason why we can't really shift to this pretty rapidly in Broward. It's really education. It's perhaps an extra ribbon. And really, those MCI drills that are seem pretty frequent here in our county, thanks to you, I think is really where we have to practice this. We do have a question from Captain Villard of Margate. At what point do you see working a gray patient in the salt system? So where do you see that happening in your view?
I see the gray patient being worked as you have 25 patients and we start getting our mutual aid coming in and we get our reds transported and now we have 20 rescue units right here. We can work our red patient, our gray patient, bump them up to a red and transport them because you have plenty of resources to be able to work a trauma code. And I'm just using that as an example. Somebody that you don't think is going to survive immediately with the resources.
Right. And then I have another one here coming from someone here in Broward County saying that many agencies across the county use the tag as the first triage tool. How do you feel about that? Is that appropriate? And if so, then the tag will have to match the salt, adding the gray in. I think that's their point.
Right. Well, hopefully in Broward County, since we've given you so many resources, I would say $1 million worth of equipment over the last 8 years, that you do have the triage ribbons available to you. It is highly recommended by the state, by us, that you use triage ribbons initially, and then you use tags as a follow-up in the treatment phase. That system has proven to be the best, a double tagging system. And if anybody wants to talk offline about how to get them and where to get them, I strongly encourage you to stay with the ribbon system and then move to the tags as your secondary tags. I can tell you many, many reasons why just using the tags themselves are not the best way to effectively use the tags. Remember, you will have on secondary triage a lot of patients will deteriorate and some patients will improve. As using START, if we say you have respirations over 30, they're automatically a red. If I'm going to use a tag, initially they're a red, and then I calm them down and they're maybe a green, I have to give that person a whole nother tag because you can't downgrade. But if I gave them a green ribbon and I bring them to the treatment area and I assess them, then I give them a tag and they're a green and they go to the green area.
Right, that's a great point. Now, there's another question here regarding for the active shooter incident. If you hear active shooter and you're en route, can you call a certain level MCI just by hearing that? Or in other words, how do you determine that? Is it determined early or do you have to kind of wait to evaluate the scene? What's your opinion on that?
Yeah, good question. What we have determined, at least in Broward County and Dade County, and these field operation guys that we have are going to go up on the state disaster EMS advisory website. And so what we have come to a consensus with is if you have a shooting incident, active shooter, any type of shooting incident, and you do not know the number of victims, the recommendation is to start off with an MCI level 2, so that would be your 11 to 20 patients, and then upgrade or downgrade once you get on scene and get more information. At least that way you can put into effect the predetermined response plan and the hospitals can start being notified right off of that announcement.
Okay, awesome. That actually makes a lot of good sense, and I think that's one of the things that we noticed that didn't, you know, people hesitate to call the MCI level, you know, even after they get on scene. And I remember that was one of the big issues is to say, hey, you know what, if it's an active shooter, just call it an MCI level 2. So I think that's really helpful. Well, excellent. I mean, listen, I learned a lot today, and I think that based on this webinar and the information you've put forward, I think we ought to start to migrate towards this you know, sooner rather than later. I think it makes a lot of sense. It brings all adults and pediatrics under one umbrella, and I think that's very helpful. So I wanted to, again, you know, thank you very much for what you've done here today. I'm going to just put up a couple more slides. Let me see if I have mine here. I'll show my screen. So again, thanks, Chief Downey, for doing this. This is, by the way, recorded. So, you know, the folks who have things like CenterLearn or Target Solutions, if you want to have this video, I will put it on a Dropbox and you can put it on your learning management software. That's one thing. The next thing I wanted to talk about is that next month's webinar, we have a few new rock stars in Broward County, which is awesome. And ever since we changed our protocol to our new stroke triage protocol, we've seen really the hospitals are really infusing a lot of money into getting the right people. And one of those people is at the Cleveland Clinic. His name is Ryan McTaggart. He came from Stanford, probably one of the nicest guys you'll meet. And he's, you know, really cares about the right thing to do. And he'll talk to us about over the last couple of weeks, there have been several articles that are coming out showing that getting patients to a center that can perform a thrombectomy on a stroke, just like back in the days with cardiac arrest, you know, there were people who were getting, you know, TPA and so forth. Now everyone goes to a PCI center for cardiac arrest. Essentially, it looks like the same thing is happening for stroke care. And the trials that just came out in the last 2 or 3 weeks are proving that the triage tool that we've been using in Broward County here for about a year and a half, almost 2 years now, was really the right decision to make. So he'll be on next week, next month. We'll send out that invitation. You can't miss it. This guy is brilliant. So we're really excited about that. Again, that's our website. And again, if you'd like CEUs, it may be a little confusing if you've never been to this website, but if you can't get to it, please email me you can email back from the email you're going to get that'll have my email address on it as a follow-up to this webinar. Okay, thank you very much, Chief Downey. Thanks again. And I think you had the record so far. We had people from around the world on this webinar and around the country. and a significant a number of people from Broward County. So
Great, thank you.
this was awesome. Thank you so much.